Good morning. I'm Henry from Takun's lab, and it's my great pleasure to be at the Slam Dunk again. I apologize that I cannot be at UNC Pembroke today. Hope you all have a great one. The title of my presentation is Analysis of Age Tau Informs Early Change of Tau Before Disease Onset. So here's a brief outline of what I will cover today. I believe there have already been great speakers giving perfect background introduction for AD. So I will skip that and directly get into why I think tau is one of the most promising therapeutic targets. Next, I will give a brief recap of my REC proposal and talk about the update of the project by showing you some interesting data. And lastly, I will conclude with the work to be done for this project. As we all know, the two hallmark pathological features for AD are A-beta plaques and tau tangles. It is still unclear how they interplay to lead to the disease. Fortunately, recent evidence suggested that the relationship between A-beta and tau in disease is like trigger and bullet. A-beta is likely to initiate the pathogenesis, but tau is the toxic species to kill neurons. Therefore, in our lab, we study tau as a therapeutic target for AD. And to study tau, its PTM status, or post-translational modification status, is very important to understand. There are hundreds of sites on tau can undergo different types of PTMs, and the status of tau is robustly associated with these PTMs. We all know that, tau hyperphosphorylation is a signature for AD. However, tau is already phosphorylated in health. When healthy, these PTMs are critical to maintain its physiological functions. Therefore, it's important to know how tau PTM evolves before disease onset. And we suspect that some certain PTM combinations could be predictors for the onset of the disease. And since aging is the primary risk factor for AD, in this study, we analyzed tau PTM involvement in wild-type mice during normal aging. And here's a quick reminder of where I started. So I identified a specific tau species, we call it H-tau, that forms in the brains of wild-type mice as a result of normal aging. And this H-tau is mislocalized, is oligomeric, acetylated, and negative for a particular phosphorylated tau epitope, S202, T205. This epitope is also called AT8. Because of this finding, in my REC project, I proposed to study this aged tau species in detail, understand how it forms, and hopefully figure out a way to reverse this process. So in the first experiment of my REC project, I used wild-type mice with four different ages, 4, 8, 12, and 20 months old, and of three for each age group. And in detail, I dissected the brains from these mice and isolated tau from hippocampus of these brains, since that's where aged tau is located. And then I sent this isolated tau to the UNC proteomics core for PTM mapping analysis. And before I show you the result, I just wanted to give you an idea of why I chose these four ages of mice. As you can see here, the figure, 4, 12, and 20 months of mouse age are approximately equivalent to mature adult, middle-aged, and old categories of human. And the 8 months old of mice is the time point between mature adult and middle-aged, which can give us some information of the status of tau right before the conversion to age tau. So here's the overview of the result. In a schematic presentation, I labeled all tau PTM sites that are significantly changed in abundance with the time point tested. So 14 PTM sites were detected, and this number is high considering there was no enrichment. However, all of them were phosphorylation sites. And one of the potential explanations is that the sequence coverage is only 43%, and the missing parts majority are within the N-terminal region and R1, R2 regions of tau, and our actually tau oscillation site is at R2. First, I want to compare this data with what we saw in the preliminary data. Unfortunately, a ciliated tau was not detected before 88. It peaked at 8 months and reduced significantly at 12 months. This epitope is interesting as the change between each time point is significant or nearly significant. And besides ATA, there are several other phosphorylated tau that marks mature tau pathology, such as S199, S396, and S404. And like ATA, all of them peak at 8 months, but unlike ATA, most of them are not bottomed out at 12 months, which could potentially explain why ATA site is so special. And next, I want to highlight several phosphorylation sites identified on the list, T181 and T231, because mounting evidence indicate that these sites are most promising sites for CSF tau biomarker development, and they're unexpectedly showing up on my list. So I analyzed the involvement of these two phosphorylated sites during normal aging, and it showed that both sites peak at the oldest age tested, which is the 20 months. And in addition, the change between 12 to 20 months for both sites are significant. And this data supports the biomarker finding and make the responsible kinases for these sites to be potential targets. So in conclusion, there are indeed tau PTMs that evolve during normal aging. And this information could be helpful for biomarker development and mechanistic study. In addition, several mature tau pathology markers, such as ATA, peak at 8 months and drop at 12 months. And this reduction may indicate a conformational change of tau during aging and before disease. Last, CSF tau biomarkers appear from PTM mapping at 12 months, and the kinases against these sites could be promising targets for investigation. So there are two parts of the future work for this project, and in part one, I will analyze human brain tissue, see if the finding in mice also exists in human. In addition, I will analyze several potential mediators for aged tau in human in different time points. And in part two, I will provide proof of concept on HDAC gene therapy to reverse aged tau. And this will involve lentiviral production and injection to wild-type mice. And hopefully this time next year, I will show you more exciting updates. And to wrap this up, I want to thank the Cohen Lab, especially Todd and everyone in the lab for all the support. And there's indeed no place like UNC. I also want to thank UNC Proteomics Core for their fantastic technical expertise. I'm also grateful for the support from ADRC REC leaders. And even though this is a recording, but I'm more than happy to have questions or feedback to my email. And thank you for listening.